Well, hello again, everyone, and welcome back to a long, 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 and long overdue episode of the Wordcraft podcast. And yes, we've been off the air for a while, but hey, it's the holidays, things like that happen. But before we dive in today into today's subject matter, before we get down to the naked woman on the screen, because we all want to know about the naked woman on the screen.
She's not naked. She's got a blanket.
She's got a blanket. You know, as always, first, we must give you a word from our sponsor.
Yes.
In 1946, an ultimate weapon was used to end the Second World War. It gave birth to a horrifying new age. This is the story of the Kaiju Age. Follow the journey of one journalist as he teams up with a retired CIA operative to uncover the truth about the monsters and the events that will ultimately culminate in a Third World War, the Great Kaiju War. See Tokyo's destruction. Witness the aerial battle of Modra and Razorbeak over New York. Explore the formation of the Kaiju Science Task Force and discover its secret mission, and witness the utter chaos of the Cuban Monster Crisis when two beasts lay waste to an entire nation. Kaiju is both a satire of the Cold War paranoia and a love letter to the kaiju genre, pioneered by the likes of Ishiro Honda and Eiji Tsubaria. Written by author Josh Finney with Mike Colbert and illustrated by Patrick McAvoy of Arkham Horror fame, World War Kaiju promises a reading experience unlike anything you've encountered.
Well, then, that looks like an incredible book, doesn't it?
It sure does.
That book looks like one of those books that, you know, if you don't own it now, you should own it tomorrow.
Or at least as quickly as Amazon can get it to you.
Yes, because, I don't know, it's just, that is a book everybody should read.
Mm-hmm. In fact, if you're in the Phoenix area in Gilbert, you can go to Antique Marketplace and pick it up in person.
Anyway, so welcome back. Welcome to the party. Merry Christmas once again.
Merry Christmas.
And why don't you give a little bit of a introduction to tonight's show?
You want me to? Okay. This is a very special episode in where the two of us have both read the same book. And I'm sorry, I'm getting a little distracted. And where the two of us have read the same book, and we are going to be reviewing it together.
Yes, Sarah Hoyt has been in the industry for a very long time. Very successful pulp writer and sci-fi writer. Mm-hmm. Hardcore libertarian, very, very influenced by Heinlein. And I actually first came across her book in writing Boobs of Steel because of the amount of, I don't know, controversy and pissing and moaning that came up about the character's boob size.
Have your stand up your vagina about it's the boob size in this book.
Yes, it's the boob size.
I'm sorry, I'm being crude on this show, and I really shouldn't be.
Well, we can be a little bit crude. I mean, this isn't the show for the blue humor as we like.
Oh, okay.
You know what the hell? What the hell are we doing?
Yeah.
We haven't even introduced ourselves. We are so unprofessional.
Oh, okay.
God damn it. Why are you so unprofessional?
It's been Christmas.
Good point.
I am Kat Rocha, the night editor. Hello, everyone. Usually I'm much more professional, but it's been the holidays and, well, screw it. And with me, as always, is...
I am Jay Ishiro Finney, author and alien in a human suit, and the author of World War Kaiju and other
you
books.
Are?
Yeah, and you know, as someone who came from another world, Zeta Reticula to yours, mm-hmm. I'm always curious what you people think, you humans think of what space is like. And this book caught my eye because of the titties.
What titties?
Well, no, in the words.
In the words, yes. Actually, in the words, she's ginormous.
Yeah, but... in the writing, she's pretty stacked. Actually, when I saw the book's cover art, I was a little shocked at how underwhelming. I mean, she looks like a kind of like ballerina build there.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, here's the new cover. Frankly, I don't think the new cover is nearly as nice as the old one. The book's been re-released. But that should give you a better sense of how stacked she is.
A little bit.
Oh, come on. That's a lot more than the other one.
No, it is an improvement. But in the book, she's 5 foot and is supposed to have tits bigger than mine.
I don't know if they're bigger than yours.
She's supposed to.
I mean, I don't think you know how big your tits are, honey.
Mine don't make me look fat.
Well, you're tall.
Yes.
And if you wear one of those shirts that, like, hangs off you like a tunic?
No, the way she described her boobs.
If she wears loose clothing, it makes her look fat.
Yes.
Okay.
Which means she has no waist if she's wearing loose fitting clothing.
Which I've seen on stacked girls. If they do not, if they're wearing baggy clothing, you can't see their waist.
Yes.
Yeah. And that's what that means.
And that's come up a couple of times. So no, she's supposed to have boobs bigger than mine, and, but she's 5 foot.
Or boobs as big as yours, but at 5 foot.
Yeah.
Okay. So, you know, and since I'm writing a book about the fact that, look, there's nothing wrong with busty characters, yeah. I figured, and this is a book written by a woman, I'll check it out. I've read the entire book. I listened to it on audio. Now, I will admit, I was listening to it every night as I went to sleep, so there might be bits and pieces that are a little fuzzy in my memory. But on the whole, I enjoyed it. I found it a very enjoyable book. It was space opera, very Heinlein-influenced. Very, very Heinlein-influenced. You could get a lot of Moon as a Harsh Mistress in there. Definitely maybe The Cat Who Walked Through Walls, a few others. But mm-hmm. It has that vibe. There are some very interesting takes. Hey, by the way, let everyone know we're live. Just get the word out. Hey, and if anyone else has... read this book, let us know.
Yeah, feel free to jump in, chime in, you know.
But when I listened to it, my take was, you know, you start with a young woman who was, what, is she 19?
Yeah, she's 19.
She's 19 years old. She's a patrician. She's a spoiled brat. There's...
You're told she's a spoiled brat.
I don't know. She pretty much acted like it.
You're told a lot. She's a spoiled brat when the drama requires her to be.
But anyway, I'm so distracted now. Anyway, the story begins. She is essentially a princess.
Mm-hmm.
There are a handful of men who run Earth, and her daddy's one of them.
Yeah.
And boy, does she have daddy issues. But I don't think that's a secret. I mean, that's pretty clear.
No, it's very clear that she has daddy issues. That's very clear from like chapter one, basically.
There's a mutiny on dad's ship. She escapes mm-hmm. and ends up having to flee into what are called the, the energy trees or?
Yeah.
And it's this weird high-tech pseudo-organic structure in space.
Well, the other cover kind of showed what they were like.
Yeah.
Let's flip back over to that.
Kind of like this giant biomechanical structure in space that somehow collects solar energy and produces like these pods that just generate massive amounts of electricity.
Mm-hmm.
And their society runs on them. And ships go out and collect these things. And it's dangerous to go in there. And she flees in her escape pod into here. Into the energy trees, and is picked up by essentially a pirate, which, you know, are rumored to exist but not exist. And she ends up being taken off by this pirate who doesn't really seem to want her around. It turns out there had been a revolution on Earth. Earth had kicked all their biogenetically engineered people off the planet, who had primarily been a servant class. And it was there was a legend that they had fled somewhere. And it's true. They did. They went, they created a civilization on this hollowed out asteroid that, I don't know, was several, I mean, it's almost a planetoid.
Yeah, it's in the belt.
Yeah, it's huge. It's a planetoid size. And they built a civilization inside it and have been living there ever since. And it's very influenced by Moon as a Harsh Mistress. And the way I took the story was this selfish, self-centered brat who has always been used to being smarter, faster, and better than everyone, and prettier than everyone, is humbled. She learns empathy. She gets her ass handed to her repeatedly. She has to start thinking of other people, which to me, I mean, that's a rarity these days. Would you agree?
What of the
spoiled brat who actually has to learn empathy and is humbled and
no, I agree.
Think of other people. And so in that part, I'm like, well, wow, I'm really impressed.
Basically, and I'm not kidding, because of the amount of Shakespeare that
is quoted,
it is Sarah Hoyt's own interpretation of Taming of the Shrew.
And then there's more where she ends up having to go back to Earth with her lover and all this. But you know what? That really, I don't want to ruin the book for you. Now, I'm not the night editor. I'm also a man. And I read the book and I got one thing. And my lovely buxom beauty of a barbarian editor here got something else.
Yeah.
Now, for me, I enjoyed it. I thought it was fun. I thought there were some weird plot holes. I thought that, okay, it's a first novel. There's a lot of gimmies, in my opinion. It's like stuff that I'm just going to let slide because it's a first novel. And it makes some mistakes that are typical early novel mistakes that everyone does. So I didn't really think much of it. But according to the buxom barbarian editor here,
there are some unforgivable.
She has a different take on this book.
Well, first, but before I get into those things, because I will say this is not the worst thing that I have read this year or the worst thing I have read ever. There is no point where I'm wanting to pick up the physical copy of the book and fling it against a wall.
May I interrupt? May I interrupt?
Okay.
So I said it was enjoyable. I read it, enjoyed it. Okay. You're talking about, I didn't want to fling it against a wall.
Yeah.
Our take on this book is that vast.
Yes.
And you said that a lot of this stuff about her being humbled and growing up, I misunderstood.
Yes. Okay.
Be my guest.
Okay. Well, no.
Look, I'm a man. Well, there's a lot of stuff with the female psyche that is a mystery to me.
First, I want to talk about the things I like and that I enjoy about this book, because this is actually a book that I'm going to say, if you wish to read it, go ahead and do so. I'm not going to tell people don't read this book. I'm not going to say this is, you know, absolutely, you know, fucking awful, because it's not. It's actually got some good ideas. I like the planet that the refugees went to, or Eden. Planetoid. They call Eden for obvious reasons, and so. You get this parallel history of how, you know, she remembers her history textbooks and her history movies of how events happened. And then she gets Eden's side of what happened. And so you get this dual history of, well, what is actually reality, or, you know, the whole perspective shift. And I really liked that. And in the end, it's no side is good, but no side is bad. It's just each side's interpretation of how that rebellion happened. You don't see that much. Or when you do, it's usually, oh my God, everything I taught was wrong and we're the assholes. And she doesn't do that. So I really liked that part. I actually do like the concept of having to steal energy resources, and it's not because they don't have the ability to come up with things themselves. It's just, well, it's easier to steal. It's like, you know what? I can't fault that logic. It's like, yeah, we could, you know, we came up with all this other stuff because we needed to, but it's just easier to steal your energy pods than to come up with our own. So that's what we did. It's like, you know, can't fault that logic. I liked the fact that resources are not limitless, although I question some of her physics on things, and I will get into that in a bit. And yeah, those are the things that I liked. I liked setting elements. When she gets into the nuts and bolts of her world, I think she struggled, but I think that's more of a beginning writer.
But there problem. Was a ton of world building. Lots yes. and lots of world building.
There's a ton of world building, and it's like she had a lot of really good ideas. But I, again, since this was what, her first book?
I believe it was. If it wasn't her first, it was one of her early books.
Since it's her first book, she hadn't quite figured out actual nuts and bolts world building yet. So it was to get her to actually explain anything, you have to back her into a corner. She has to write herself into a corner to actually explain how nuts and bolts work in this world. Otherwise, it's just vagaries. It's like, oh, well, you know, we just have this world and, you know, people just live in it. It's like, wait, your world has no laws? No, we have no laws. Then how do you function?
It's like, we have very strong traditions.
Yes, we have very strong traditions. It's like, but you have contracts. Yes, contract is law. It's like, but we have no laws. It's like, we have no lawyers. It's like, the fuck?
Contracts were based on honor and handshakes.
Yeah, honor, handshakes, and if you get pissed off and kill somebody, you have to pay their family money.
Yeah, the blood geld.
And it's like, and people are, it's like, how do you not degenerate into deadwood on this? It's like, because reasons.
Well, I could argue why it didn't degenerate into deadwood.
Mm-hmm.
There have been instances in societies where it's the type of people.
I will have a counter to that.
Yeah.
Yes. Japan.
Okay, what about Japan?
It's class.
Yeah.
Class keeps it in line. If a lower class fisherman flipped out and decided to try to knife a samurai, not only him, but his entire family would get slaughtered. So it's class. Mm-hmm. You know, two samurai can go at it, fine. There may be repercussions, but it's okay because they're on the same class. This world has no class. There's no class structure.
Except in time, you start to realize there is.
There is, but there's no formal class.
No, structure. It's not formally admitted, but as time goes on, you start to realize, no, there's class.
Well, there's no class structure in the idea of, you know, yes, the pirates, as we're going to call them, when they come back, yeah, they're fucking rock stars because they're bringing back very important resources for the world. And yes, you become kind of a rock star figure the more successful you are at it. But that's not really class. That's mm-hmm. notoriety. That's fame. That's other things. So, and people give Doc Bartholomew respect, but that's not class.
Now, I could be wrong. Maybe I'm filling in gaps that weren't there, but I kind of got the sense there was class based on skill set, on how important you were, how much you were needed.
Where I am in the book, that has not come across.
And that's what came across to me was, okay, technically they don't have class, but let's face it. If you've got an important job, if you've got a job that's going to keep people alive or keep the ships running or whatever, you're more important than the guy who just sits around home and jerks off.
I saw it more as, does your family have enough money to afford gene mods? Because it's more rich than class. Mm-hmm. It's a economic system, not a class system.
I would also say the other thing that keeps this society held together, Deadwood, everyone's there to either hide from the law or get rich.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? That's a certain kind of person. Everyone on Eden is a refugee.
No, they're not.
They are all the descendants who were scared shitless that one day Earth is going to kill them.
That is true.
And that does hold them together,
mm-hmm.
is this notion that one day Earth is going to knock on their door and kill all of them.
And that's my other problem with this book is she is an Earther. Not only is she an Earther, she's basically a princess who has come here. And Sarah Hoyt has a real problem with showing the real prejudice and fear that would come with that. She shows up on this world. People know exactly what she is here, and yet they welcome her with open arms. They give her a job. And when their pirate ships start disappearing, they just leave her alone. There's no outward animosity. There's no outward fear. There's no outward attacks on her. And we've already established that people aren't afraid to outwardly attack somebody if they're pissed off at them. So where are the scenes of pirate ships are disappearing, or you're getting actual reports of them exploding and those families coming after her for retribution? You don't get any of that.
Now,
because they're scared. They believe it's because of her that their ships are disappearing.
Now, maybe this is where we remember it differently. Now, I do recall it being a little too easy for her.
Oh, it's very easy for her.
But that she had pretty much no one would come within, 5 feet of her. No one would talk to her. She was living in pretty much complete isolation. And the only reason she wasn't being attacked was that there was the effect that if they attacked her, there was the blood guild that they would have to answer to Kit and his family, who were powerful.
That is true, except that it has very well been established that these people don't seem to really care that much. Kit is considered a murderer and therefore already a pariah of that society. Yes, the male love interest in this, everyone thinks he's a murderer. There's no proof. Everyone suspects it, and he does nothing to remove that suspicion. So she is the protected ward of a murderer.
I'm guessing you did not get to this part in the book.
She does clear his name. I know that. That's a spoiler, but sorry.
But when she talks to Doc Bartholomew, mm-hmm. he says, is that what he told you? No, it's not just that.
No, it's what she got from her coworkers. See, that's the other thing. Mm-hmm. When she got her first job working in the... First off... She's a princess. She is a spoiled brat. It is established in chapter one that she goes on drunken, drug-induced orgies all the fucking time. She doesn't have to work, and she gets her kicks out of beating the crap out of random men because she can and stealing things. I'm not kidding. So, but she's a spoiled brat who's never done anything in her fucking life for anybody. And when she gets to Eden, she's randomly, yeah, okay, I can work. That's fine. It's like, you want to work? Why do you want to work? You're a princess. There's no reason in fucking hell why she would be this gung-ho to work. Physical labor. So that's unbelievable thing, number one, but okay, I'll let it slide. Her coworkers love her. And in fact, there's one girl, the group gossip, who comes and tells her everything. And the group gossip is the one who comes and tells her about, oh, well, you don't know? Well, you know, Kit murdered his wife, and that's why there's all of this. And, you know, so she finds out from the group gossip.
Yeah, I'm remembering it differently because I remember them all kept calling her Earthworm and not liking her, but
no, they loved her. Her co-workers loved her. They don't start not liking her until Kit leaves without her, and then all the pirate ships start disappearing. And then she starts hearing them call her Earthworm behind her back, and they stop talking to her.
And as far as I recall, the reason she was so gung-ho to work was that she was enraged at the notion of having to be dependent on anyone, because Kit and his family were like, oh, don't worry, we'll just put you up. Don't worry, you don't have to do anything.
No, actually.
And that she despised the notion of having to be in debt to anyone or to owe anyone or need anyone.
No, that developed later. That developed later because she shows up on the planet. She meets his parents. And the very next day, his sister takes her down to go get the job. Like the very next day. And because they're like, oh, you know how you can do mechanic stuff? It's like, yeah, you did mechanic stuff a lot at home. I've got, basically, she's got a grav racer, but they call them brooms.
They're essentially the speeder bikes from Star Wars. No, seriously.
No, they're a stick.
No. Later in the book.
Yeah.
Seriously, later in the book, you get to see them.
But her first description of them is that they're a stick with an engine on it.
Generally.
Yeah.
But they're essentially the speeder bikes in Star Wars.
Yeah.
Because later, it figures big into the plot near the end.
I figured it would, considering how much she's shoving it into our face all the time. Sorry.
No, I just kind of wonder if Hoyt likes motorcycles, to be honest with you.
She can like motorcycles, but it's like, yeah, I work on this, I do that. And she also has some tech empathy, if you're going to use RPG terms. And so they're like, oh, well, then you would be great working in the yards. And it's just assumed, oh, you're going to work. And she's like, okay, well, then I'll go down there tomorrow and get the job. And they're like, well, are you sure you think that that'll be the best job for you? She goes, yeah, I'll be fine. It'll be great. And it's not till later that she's talking about how she does try to pay for things while she's working there and they won't let her. But her job kind of just happens. And that's my other problem with what I mean by Sarah doesn't explain things unless she's shoved into a corner and has to. It's just, well, it's accepted that my character is going to get a job here and I can't be bothered to explain anything or to actually put, realistic scenes. I'm just going to have it happen so I can get to the scenes I want to write, which happens a lot when we get to Eden. Before Eden, everything's pretty even.
Pretty solid.
Pretty solid. A couple of nizz, but it's like, oh, I'll give it to her. Once you get to Eden, she has a real problem with, I want to write this scene. I'm bored with this scene. I want to write this scene. I don't want to write this scene.
I did not like the part at the beginning when she's fleeing the mutiny.
Mm-hmm.
And she lands on the space station. Kit rescues her. She's blacked out and we have no idea what happened.
Yeah.
It's like one moment she's in trouble, the next she wakes up and she's been rescued.
And that happens a lot.
And I did think that was like, you'd want to know, right?
Yeah.
That'd be like the first thing you'd ask. Mm-hmm. Was like, what'd you do?
Yeah.
What the fuck happened? Not, oh, well, I'm safe now.
No, there's a lot of problems with that where it's just either, character wakes up and things that she found difficult to write have just happened magically, so she doesn't have to write them. Or she'll say, yeah, this thing happened, which is one of her unforgivable sins.
Well, before we get into your list of unforgivable sins, because you are the night editor.
Okay.
And whereas I just read it passively, you came at it with a broadsword.
Well, wait,
is that really an appropriate weapon for you? What would be the boob goddess of editing's weapon of choice? Double bladed axe, battle axe, a broadsword.
Well, since this is sci-fi, I'm going to say I had a lightsaber.
Seems like kind of a small weapon for you.
It's not small.
Oh, you can they be any size?
Yes.
Really?
Yes.
I forget you're the Star Wars expert.
Yeah, they can be any size. You can either dither it down to shorten or lengthen your
Why don't we ever see that in the movies?
I don't know. I mean, you've got Yoda with his little
There's a couple scenes there was a couple scenes in Empire where I think Luke could have used the lightsaber at like switchblade size.
Well, also Vader's got two of them. That's when Vader's a dual wielder. You never saw it.
Okay, well, I'm not going to question this because I don't know. Other than the ships, which really interest me, I don't know much about Star Wars. You are a bizarre expert, and that's not the topic of this show.
No, it is not.
Although we should probably review a Star Wars novel just because you're such an expert.
Like one of the Zahn books?
Yeah.
I'd love to reread them, and, you know, well, I love Thrawn.
Well, I'm reading that Thrawn one that you recommended.
I thought you finished it.
No, I had to stop because Mara Jade was becoming too much of a whiny bitch. And I needed a break from her whiny bitchiness.
That's okay.
I was getting really sick of all the scenes where gets to be a whiny bitch and Luke's all, it's okay. I'm a good guy.
It's okay, nummy head.
And it's like, you know what? Both of you can just shut up and go to hell. Let's get back to Han.
You're the perfect couple.
But anyway, back to this book.
Okay.
I thought I'd explain a few things before we dive any deeper.
Okay.
Sarah Hoyt here comes from Portugal. Mm-hmm. Now, you said one of the coolest things in this book, and I agree, were the two perspectives on history.
Yeah.
She grew up in Portugal as a communist country.
Oh.
And managed to get to the United States.
Wow. Okay.
And got to read two different versions of history.
That makes sense.
And she even was talking about how in Portugal they taught that Marx was a Russian.
Okay.
And, you know, Castro was a great hero. And
oh, wow.
So she was raised with one history. Mm-hmm. And then she comes to the United States where you can just seek out any information you want.
Yeah, it's not hidden. I mean, we've got entire stores that sell it.
And you get as many conflicting views as you want on history.
That too.
And it was like, wait a minute. It was just, so I think she was writing from experience in that.
Yeah.
Second, the lovely Miss Hoyt here is an engineer. And one of those rare females who is ridiculously mathematically inclined.
Which is cool.
And so that was going to bring me to one of my other bizarre takes on the book. It was because she's an engineer and has a very solid grasp of science. There were things in this where it was just space opera, where it's like, okay, well, fuck it. It works this way because it works this way. You know, the Star Wars rule. Mm-hmm. It's this way because it's this way. Don't ask. Or like in Star Trek, well, if you've got the transporter, why can't you have immortality?
Yeah,
you can just clone as many bodies as you want. Well, because
for reasons.
Yeah, that's space opera, right? Yeah. But then there were other things in the story where she would give us the technical description of how something worked. And it's like, I didn't need to know that. Not only did I not need to know that, that kind of conflicts with everything else now.
Yeah, because if there's that much detail on one thing, then
there would be certain things where it's like, well, wait, everything. She would point out flaws in the logic and then re-explain, well, why it did work. And it's like, you know, that is a flaw I would have never picked up unless I was an engineer.
Yeah.
You didn't need to tell me as an engineer how they overcame that flaw.
Yeah.
Like, no. And so that was a little strange. And I've got to think that that was just the OCD engineer in her thinking, no, I'm an engineer. I cannot just leave this alone. I must explain why this flaws, how they overcame this bit of physics.
Actually, I just figured because a lot of her writing seems to be just what sounded good to her at the time. So she'd come up with something and it's like, oh, and then her brain would start figuring out how to make it actually work. So she put it on the page. That's what I got.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just the engineer brain kicked in and.
Yeah. And just she wrote what was in her head. And it's like, this sounds really cool. And then she moved on.
Whereas in my opinion, when you do space opera, either you do real, you probably shouldn't do real science in space opera. You should have pseudoscience or bullshit science.
Yeah. I mean,
Star Wars is like the epitome of bullshit science.
Yes.
Oh, well, it's a crystal inside the lightsaber. That's why it works.
Well,
the hyperdrive works because.
Because.
Because why? Because.
Because. You don't need to know. It's not part of the story. It doesn't matter.
Well, shit.
All you need to know is it working? Good. Is it not? Okay, now you have to fix it.
Whereas we'll talk about a franchise I know a lot more about. Star Trek tried to get to the point of accuracy where they had to come up with like bullshit reasons why the ship wouldn't tear itself apart with that saucer and pylon configuration because it was unstable.
Yeah.
And so they had to come up with this bullshit explanation. It's like, no, don't even bother. It's the future. It works.
Yeah. It works because of reasons.
I mean, look, you're not writing 2001 here. We don't need accuracy.
But it is because of that you do have engineers and mathematicians and other people like that who love Star Trek. Because they love the fact that they can pull out actual, like, blueprints and charts and know, like, exact energy consumption of certain things.
Yeah. Oh, God. No. Okay. See, we're going to do a different Star Wars show because I just opened a goddamn Pandora's box. Look what we got here.
Vader's blade is actually too long, longer than the average lightsaber.
Okay. We're stopping all the Star. No, we'll do a Star Wars show. We are focusing on Sarah Hoyt's book.
Yes.
Because it's about Sarah Hoyt's book. Okay.
Yes.
And I'm just going to call it, okay? Short, big boobs, dark hair.
Yes.
Can we say?
Yes.
Okay.
And.
No, that's fine. That actually is fine.
No, that's fine. No, here's my problem with our main character. You can have the spoiled brat princess who's basically living the Paris Hilton lifestyle, who, you know, her entire world is shattered when her father's men mutiny. They actually get her back for a short time, and she finds out that they're going to do not so nice things to her. So she has to go to Eden. There's no other place for her to go. Her entire world is just, you know, completely, utterly destroyed, and she's having to learn a completely new set of rules, work in a completely new system. She's not the princess anymore. She doesn't have servants and other things like that, and she's having to learn to work, you know, to do things for others. That is one story. Another story is you have a girl who may be relatively well off, who there's a mutiny, who finds out that she can't go home because she has something that they want from her, and she has to go to this new place, and she's going to try to make it work, and she's going to find her place in this world. And, you know, one of those things is you work. And if you work, now you're part of society. You're contributing. And that's how you show your worth. You cannot have both.
Okay, I will have one more question. Did you read to the part where she tried to steal a ship?
Yes.
Okay.
And how everybody forgave her in 24 hours.
But they didn't.
Yes, they did. They did. Why? Because Kit paid for it. They hold Kit responsible. They don't care about her. They hold Kit responsible for what she did.
Yeah.
He's perfectly willing to pay for it all. And the next day she goes back to her fucking job like nothing happened.
But people treat her differently.
No, they do not.
Okay, we're going to disagree on this one. I'll have to go look it back up. I recall them all being very cold to her and keeping a distance after she did that.
No, they were already cold and keeping their distance from her.
But, Wolf, is this a joke about Vader being black?
It's the same comment.
I know, but it just hit me. Are you implying that because Vader's black, he's longer than the app? Am I just dense here?
But it's right at the tip.
But, okay. Okay, so let's get to your list of your... there's two things I want to discuss. Mm-hmm. There was the scene that stuck out to me as I thought was really good, because it was like the scene where she finally breaks down and explodes on Kit, mm-hmm. and realizes what an asshole she's been. Mm-hmm. And it's the part after the trial.
She doesn't realize how much of an asshole.
See, and she breaks down, and they decide, okay, they're together.
That is not what happened.
Now, I read that and took it as, okay, it finally all came crashing down. What a complete cunt she is.
Nope.
And she's been humbled and realizes, okay, this guy's been right the whole time.
Until, now you have to, I would say yes, because that is part of it. Those are some of the thoughts that go through her head. But the casual sexism in this book is amazing. And she cannot have a man be right. So she then turns it around to, you're still the jerk in this. How dare you? You get mad at me because I'm in there and I'm saving your ass, you selfish prick.
Oh, holy crap. You know, I know you're just pretending here that that was just an act. But I've got to admit that... just that female tone in general, like, makes me want to shoot myself.
I'm with you on this. I am with you. Because, you know, it's like, you have no right, bitch, to be angry at him. You know? You got up. She got up in front of, you know, not only a crowd, but they advertised. Because, you know, you need witnesses, and also, let's face it, people are going to find this amusing. She advertised that she had shared some memories with Kit concerning the death of his wife, his first wife, and everybody thinks that he murdered her. And so she was going to go, I'm going to do a public tell-all. And they fucking advertised that she was going to do this. So there's a crowd there. While she airs his dirty laundry, basically, and talks about how, no, he didn't murder this woman, but it's something he didn't want public to know. It was very private to him. And she gets mad at him that she did this without his permission or consent.
Okay, so let's get to the scene. The scene where I thought this was her being humbled and finally realizing what a little selfish brat she's been. And is the growing up moment. And you're telling me that, no, I don't understand the female mind, that she's just fucking crazy.
Yes.
And, well, explain that to me and every other male in the audience who just does not understand female logic. Oh my God. No, hold on. Kat's eyes just grew like four sizes and she bared her teeth on that one, like she was going to kill somebody. Maybe I should have turned the camera on for this one, because Kat is so animated in this one. She's swinging her arms and shaking her fist as she's talking. She's so heated about this. And that's why I keep interjecting, so that she doesn't blow up.
No.
You got to talk in the mic.
I know. Okay. Why do I say that? Well, the fact that she kicks him in the groin several times. She tries to punch him. They actually wind up in a fist fight. And the reason why is because he's not thanking her for airing his personal and private thoughts. So she gets mad and screams at him. And when he tries to talk sense into her and try to explain things, she says, no, let me out, because he's driving. And you're like, no, let me out of the car now. You know, if you don't let me out now, I'm going to jump. So he lets her out and she like huffs off. And it's just, this scene is just, it's supposed to be dramatic and totally out of, you know, one of those, Hallmark rom-coms. And instead, she's just this selfish bitch who doesn't understand why he wouldn't be happy that she had done what she had done for him. And it's like, men, I hate men. They're just trying to, they just want to lecture you all the time. I'm not kidding.
Oh, yeah. She says that quite a bit. She's always bitching about men lecturing to her.
You know, she's talking about how selfish men are and how they keep trying to tell her what to do. And it's like, you bitch.
I took that more as her daddy issues coming to the surface.
No, it's chick issues.
Because, you know, men lecturing me.
But remember, she gets into that bitch session with his sister, and his sister is more than happy to agree with her.
Well, that's just that's just chicks always siding with each other, no matter how unreasonable.
Yeah, that's because they're chicks. That scene is not... Yes, you are too male for this shit. That scene
That should be a line from, like, a Die Hard film. I'm too male for this shit.
No, that scene is not her realizing how selfish she's been. That scene is her ramping herself up to, she can't feel bad that she has done something that, you know, though she was trying to help. And yes, she was trying to help. And he does come to accept and appreciate what she was trying to do for him. But she also can't accept the fact that she did something really stupid and that what she did could have also been very hurtful to him. She can't be in the wrong. So they have a fight about it.
Okay, so how about the guilt that she was racked with when she stole the ship and she didn't get punished, he did?
Yes, but the difference is they did not have a discussion about it. She just sat there and
she listened. Never told him.
She never told him. She didn't tell. The only person she told was his sister. She never told him that she felt bad about it. And anytime she tried to, you know, say anything, he just say, no, there's no discussion. And he would cut it off.
All right. Next up. You don't like female writers.
As a rule, no.
And there's a list of unforgivable sins that female writers do.
Well, no, Sarah specifically has done two unforgivable sins that any writer could do.
And that's what I want to get to is okay. Now let's get to you've explained our misunderstanding where I thought this was a growth moment for the character. You're saying, no, she's just.
No, this was the third act breakup so that they could get to the shotgun wedding. And I'm not kidding because you go from her airing his dirty laundry publicly to them driving home and them getting into this fight to them immediately going down to the town hall and getting married, all within the span of 3 hours.
So you're telling me that as a logical male, this chick shit is just too confusing and crazy for me to understand.
It's anytime you think she's being altruistic, she's not.
Okay.
It's either self-serving or she's not thinking about it.
Well, okay then.
I'm sorry.
You know, I would love to get a few other females in the audience to read this and give their opinion because, I mean, one of the things I love about this show is we've got females that are like of cat's mind. They're not your average female. They're more of the barbarian variety.
It's basically, she doesn't know she's selfish.
And never realizes it.
And never realizes it. Or so far, I haven't finished the book. I'm about 2/3 of the way through. But, you know, 2/3 of the way through, she still hasn't figured out that she's selfish.
All right. Now let's get to the unforgivable sins. And the audience is saying they don't mind you being angry and heated. So go ahead.
Okay.
So let loose. You know what? You know what? I was wrong. Lightsaber, no. Broadsword, no. Chainsword.
Chainsword.
Two-handed chainsword is the weapon of this editor.
Assault rifle with a chainsaw attachment.
Or that. All right, let loose. What are the unforgivable sins in your opinion?
Okay. We've talked about how pirate ships are going out to... Yes, I'd love to hear Eloise's review of this. You have... pirate ships going out to collect these energy pods. Oh, thank you, Wolf. and, you know, this is dangerous work to begin with, but now it seems like they're being hunted. And ships are blowing up or just disappearing. And it's very tense time. And Kit's sister goes out because she's also a pirate, and her ship goes out, and a ship comes back. Oh, she's about a week late coming back, and another ship comes back, and its hold is only half full, but they're coming back as heroes because they actually came back. And that was cool. That was a great tense scene, right? And, you know, so, and they're telling about what they've been seeing, because this is the first ship to come back since they've started disappearing or blowing up. And they tell of the story of how, of basically fighting within the energy trees. And Kit's sister's ship, they said, flat out exploded. There is no question. And the way it exploded, there is no room for there to be survivors. This is sad. Okay? This is a sad moment. Five chapters later, it's like, Kit's sister was helping me with this. Oh, yeah, she came back. It's like, excuse me, what? You just do an offhanded comment. Oh yeah, she came back. She fucking exploded. You made it very clear. Her ship exploded in a very dramatic scene. And she's just back. It's like, you forgot that you needed her later in the story. So you just said, oh yeah, she came back. You know, we're not going to dwell on that. We're just going to move on. It's like, no. You pulled a Marvel. You killed somebody and then you brought them back because you wanted them for the rest of your story. It's like, what the fuck? So that's unforgivable sin number one. Don't fucking do that. You can have somebody, the reports of their death are greatly exaggerated. You can have that, but work it into your plot, for fuck's sake.
Okay.
Okay, so that's one of them. Okay, two. There is a lot of this world, the way it functions, is reliant upon duels. You know, duels of honor. Where, you know, if you, like, there's this guy, Joseph, who is Kit's wife's brother. And he keeps trying to challenge Kit to a duel for the honor of his family.
Okay, I found that all very amusing.
Yeah, it was great. It was a great element to the story. You know, for the honor of his family, because he's convinced that Kit has killed his sister.
And
Kit does nothing to say otherwise, really.
He takes a shot in the arm and still does nothing about it.
What? Oh, Kit?
Yeah.
Yeah.
He gets shot. Oh, well, actually, it's more in the upper shoulder.
Yeah.
And because he's so hell-bent on not disgracing his former wife's family.
Yeah.
And so hell-bent on not killing her brother and not proving everyone right.
Yeah.
He doesn't want, everyone claims he's a killer. He wants to show, no, I'm not a killer.
Yeah.
I thought that whole plot was great.
I thought it was great, too. I thought it could have been better executed, but, you know, whatever. But as far as a plot goes, a plot device and complications and other things like that, you know, yes, that was great. And
I have one more.
Okay.
I also loved the A Christmas Story moment where she pulls a Ralphie on him and tackles him and starts beating the crap out of him, screaming incoherently.
Yeah.
On Joseph?
Yeah.
I mean, come on. That was like straight out of A Christmas Story.
Oh, it was.
Ralphie goes berserk on the bully. She does the exact same thing
on Joseph.
Yeah. I loved that.
Yeah, that was cool. And very much so warranted, because this was right after Joseph had shot Kit. So she basically saw red and went after him.
Well, he took a shot at her.
Oh, did he?
Yeah. She was coming home from work. This is when everyone was suspecting her of being a traitor. And she's going back to her car, and Joseph takes a shot at her. And she snaps, jumps on him, and pulls a Ralphie.
I read that different.
No, but Kit was out in space.
Oh, no, she doesn't pull a Ralphie at that point.
And she beats the ever-living crap out of him?
Not at that point.
will disagree on this.
No. At that point, she by beating the ever-living crap out of him, you mean she punched him once in the face and kicked him once in the groin and then said, I challenge you to a duel.
I remember it differently.
No, she doesn't beat the shit out of him because, Kit told her not to kill him. So she says, I'll challenge you to a duel instead. Anyway, the point is that she challenges Joseph to a duel because he keeps trying to go after Kit. And Kit can't duel him for reasons. I'm not going to get into them right now. So there's a lot of time spent on her going to different people and learning the rules of dueling or how it's, the proper way to do it. And, oh, I don't have to fight him to the death. Okay, good. It's just to knockout or just to first blood, basically. All the different things that ins and outs that go with it. And she even says flat out that she spent a month and a half preparing for this duel. So you're expecting a duel. You're expecting, the ring in the sand and people in there and maybe even somebody with drums. I'm exaggerating, but and she's gonna fight him bare knuckles, so you're expecting something, any sort of actual description of a fight, and there's not. In fact, it is told in reverse, and what I mean by that is she's talking about something else and she goes, oh yeah, when I'm out with Kit's sister and I think they were going shopping, right after the duel, we were talking about this. I'm like, wait, right after the duel? When did the duel happen? You've just now revealed that you're perfectly fine. What happened? And she goes, oh yeah, the duel was nothing. I just punched him once and he went down and that was it. It's like, the fuck? Like, you just spent all this time building up dueling and how important it was. We're expecting a fight, you dumb bitch. And all you said was, I downed him in one punch and left? That's it? The hell? So, no, that is another unforgivable sin. If you are going, that'd be the equivalent of having the dueling pistols and having everybody talk about using them and building up to the moment of, yes, I'm going to use them on this particular day, and then cutting to dinner the night after. It's like, so how'd the duel go? It's like, it was fine. I shot him. It's done. And that would be it. That was the equivalent. It's like, the fuck? Even if she did just one punch him and that really was it, have the scene, woman, shit, have everybody like warming up, have her try to talk him out of it, have him spout some shit to her about, how she's, some, dumb earthworm who's wasting her time with this murderer, and how could she defend him, and really maybe even get in more into his mind, because he's never talked about it. He just shows up, tries to attack Kit, and leaves through the entire story. So that would have been a great scene to really get into his mind and for her to see how much it really hurt his family that his sister was dead. And then she could one punch him and leave if she really wanted to. But build it up. Have the scene.
Okay, I found it.
You found it?
Why don't you read them?
Okay.
Start from when.
Which scene is this?
This is the when she beats the crap out of Joseph.
Okay. Now, if I remembered it wrong, then I remembered it wrong.
Well, I want to make sure. So okay. It starts with when.
Okay. When I left the compound late at night, exhausted for a moment, it was as though I was back on the day of my arrival with Kit, particularly because I was using his flyer. The compound wasn't empty, or at least the garage wasn't, as several people had worked double shifts. We were trudging into the garage where the light was burning at half power when I heard a sound. I can't tell you what made me pick the sound over the scraping of feet, the opening of flyer doors, the slamming of other doors, the whoosh of warming engines, but I did. It was the slip-slide of a burner safety being pulled off. Because in mind, I was back to my arrival here with Kit, I dropped to the floor before even thinking, and as if it were a bad reaction of that day, a burner ray flew over me, burning a hole into the pilot door exactly where it had been before. I couldn't think, at least not clearly, but I could move. Before I could stop, I had leapt into the direction of the sound and the ray had come from, and I landed on Joseph Cavill. Not being rational or under my own control, I was wild, insane, a state I normally only reached at the end of furious fights, which is entirely inaccurate, because she flies into that state a lot. Anyway, each of my actions registered only as I completed it, and I became aware I had done it. I had torn the burner for Clavel's hands and thrown it, not caring if the safety was off and it might fire and hit. And I hit him hard in the place that Kit said I liked hitting men, and then both knees before he could fall. She likes kicking men in the groin. A lot.
And it's established it's because she has issues.
Yes. Yeah. And because I wasn't rational, I found myself standing over a man curled in a fetal position while I rained punches on him. Okay, I hadn't remembered
that.
See,
I told you she went berserk on him.
You're right. With my bare hands and screamed an incoherent babble about his being a murderer, about his having tried to kill Kit, about my killing him now. I stopped to catch my breath, my face covered in tears, my breath coming in ragged sobs. Through those sobs, I heard voices from the crowd that had assembled to watch this. Yeah. She attacked him for no reason, one said, clearly having missed the first shot. She's going to kill him. Cursed earthworm protecting that murderer. Yeah. And I realized with a sudden shock that I was doing exactly what I told Kid I wouldn't do. Yes, she had promised him he wouldn't murder anybody. I had promised him not to get in trouble. I had promised him not to kill anyone and not to make him pay blood geld. All of me, all of my impulses, all of my thoughts wanted to kill, to destroy, to maim, but I couldn't. Not to have yet another debt accrued to Kit. Not the fact that it would be murder. Think of, she's from Earth. It would be murder to her. And she doesn't realize it's murder.
No, she doesn't care.
So she's a sociopath.
That could be.
And a psychopath. That was my other problem with this, is she adopts their, oh, murder's fine mentality very easily. All of me, all of my impulses, all of my thoughts wanted to kill, to destroy and maim, but I couldn't. Oh, I already read that part, sorry. Well, anyway.
So, yeah.
Okay, so you're
she,
right. You're
she
right.
Really did pull a Ralphie from Christmas Story. She finally just snapped on the dude and beat the ever-living crap out of him. And she even had the ranting incoherent. So, I mean, it wasn't like a kick and a punch and he was down.
No, see, that's how I interpreted it. But, you know, you are correct.
So I'm just going to say, do you think maybe your bias might have blinded?
No.
No.
We can go through each scene.
No, I don't think we need to go through each scene. But, but see, I read that so differently than you.
That's okay. We can remember things differently.
But
and I admitted I was wrong. So there you go. No. Oh, Lord, story from a first person perspective. That's an unforgivable sin for me.
Well, screw you too, dude. I write first person perspective.
First person can be fine. It's a great way to do it. It's just the writer themselves needs to recognize that first person is always going to be an unreliable narrator. And if you, the writer, don't realize that your narrator is unreliable, you have problems.
You know, Scars is written in first person perspective. Case File Arkham's written in first person perspective.
Mm-hmm.
Death War Grease Paint isn't. Yeah, no, there's nothing wrong with, you know, just about every great noir novel is written in first-person perspective. There's nothing wrong with that. I think, I don't know where you get that impression, Damien, but I will say that does tend to be a God, okay. You're a listener. I'm trying not to be mean. That's often a perspective of literary snobs, to be upfront. That is often a thing literary snobs will say to talk down about pulp fiction or light entertainment.
Or it could just be Damien hasn't read much from first person that they like. I mean, there was a period there for a while when I was reading very heavily in high school where most of the stuff I was enjoying was all first person perspective. And then when I would switch to third, I didn't like it because I was used to first person and it took me a while to get used to it. So it could just be that. It's also different genres lend themselves to different narrating styles. So.
Yeah, one of the number one things about first-person perspective is the advantage of limited point of view. And I do say advantage. It's also a hindrance, but it's an advantage because it means that, one, if the character doesn't understand something, it's an excuse to explain to the reader without it being blunt exposition.
Mm-hmm.
Second, it also means that... the character, if the character is unaware of something or gets tricked, you're tricked along with them,
mm-hmm.
or you have to take their word for it. So you experience it along with them when things go to shit.
True. You can sort of do that with third person, but it's one of those things where, as in the third person perspective, you're getting the inside thoughts of your main character. So it's more like you, the outsider, are reading their mind.
Keep talking for a little bit.
Okay. Well, let's see. Horizon Talker. First-person perspective is heavily used in literature in the last 100 to 150 years, but most books, I kind of doubt that.
Huh?
Talking about first-person perspective.
Let's see.
I'd say the third person is the most common in fiction.
Okay.
So, oh, Randy! Hey, Randy!
Hey, how you doing, Randy? Okay, so I'm going to read you a scene from Titanium Rain. And it's a scene where the pilot gets, well, he thinks he's been shot. He kind of does, but it's not what you think.
Mm-hmm.
He's not nearly as bad. He's injured bad, but not as bad as he thinks.
Mm-hmm.
And I drew from my own experience on this one.
Yeah.
This is the one where I reached deep into my own when I got shot and tried to pull this out. Okay. I scream. I need to scream. I need to let it out. Can't. Won't. Something inside refuses to give. I reject fear. Reject death. This moment will not be my last. The terror is wiped away, replaced with a sense of hyper-awareness. Everything I am, every thought, every nerve, every cell locks into perfect symmetry in a unified and hell-bent notion of one thing. I will survive. I don't think that would come across as well in third person. And I can say the same for Scars when I was writing about the post-traumatic stress. And I will say Scars is, while it's a fiction story, I mean, it's science fiction through and through. I actively chose to have Scars written in first person because so much of it I am pulling directly autobiographically from my own experience of coming through post-traumatic stress. And I'll be honest with you, the confessional nature, and I do mean confessional nature of first person, is incredibly powerful. What?
Sorry, and continue what you're saying, and then I'll...
So in that regard, there's a scene where the character in Scars is talking about taking all the various drugs that's been prescribed to make the panic go away. And the experience of waiting as the clock ticks down to actually turn those parts of the brain off. Talking about the nightmares, the night terrors, the... memories of almost dying. It just did not have the same impact in third person. And so I would go easy on the idea that first person is the narrative of the peasant.
never said that.
No, no, I'm talking about how literary types talk.
Oh, the comment that I put back up was him saying that he doesn't like it reading like it's a diary entry, which is how this reads.
Oh, I see. Because, you know, no, there are a lot of types that will rip on first person. And I'll be honest, I went to college. I took creative writing classes, and boy, I got a shitload of, oh yeah, first person perspectives. That's low writing. Real literature is, yeah. And some, it took me forever to learn that's bullshit.
Real literature like Camus.
Yeah, exactly. And so, yeah, it took me a very long time to break through that notion that first person is the literature, is the voice of the peasantry, and that high writing is third person. That's all.
Okay.
So I'm not, no, that's not directly aimed at whoever I was talking to.
No, he was
Damien. That's not aimed at him.
Yeah, no, Damien was saying that the problem is this book reads like a diary entry, which it does.
Well, so does Dracula, though.
That's different.
Why?
Because it is diary entries.
Oh, I see.
It's actual diary entries and correspondence, as well as news reports. And they say flat out that they are sharing notes, and everybody has to write down the things that they experience every day so that they don't forget it. And there's even a point where their notes get destroyed by Dracula, but luckily Mina had copies.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's actually worked into the narrative.
Okay, so JC names a bunch of good first-person perspective books. I'm going to nix Catcher in the Rye. I thought it actually that we're just not going to go there. Clockwork Orange, oh, hell yeah. That's one of my favorite books. Gatsby, yes. 1984, I don't think would have been nearly as terrifying in third person.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't read American Psycho.
I tried. I got bored.
Fight Club was great. And yeah, I love just about anything Philip K. Dick's written.
Oh, Scanner Darkly. I don't see how you could do it.
Again, and the thing is, a Scanner Darkly is a confessional style book. It's mm-hmm. him kind of confessing how much he screwed up.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
I don't know if that's really how you call it, what you'd call the style, but I've noticed there's a style of first person that's almost like you're just bearing your soul to the reader saying, look, this is who I am.
Mm-hmm. Or, you know, just this is my story and I have to get it out somehow.
Yeah, Mike Hammer first person's great because he's such an asshole. I love the Mike Hammer books because he is such a jerk. All right.
I like Horizon Talker's comment. Dracula's found document novel.
You know, you're right. You could make an argument that that's actually found footage.
Yeah, it is totally found footage the way it's written.
It's not first person. It's a found footage narrative.
Well, because so much of it is correspondence between different people. It's people's diaries. Like I said, it's news reports of what are coming on. That's how they found out about the ship coming in. The ghost ship is mm-hmm. it's a news report.
Which I like. I like mm-hmm. doing that a lot. I do that a lot in my own work.
Mm-hmm.
By the way, Randy, glad you joined us. We need to have you on the air again.
It's been too long.
I know that we were going to do that monthly, but it's the holidays.
Yeah, we need to hook up.
I think we're all under the note. Yeah, it's the holidays. That's why we're not doing the monthly meetup.
Yeah.
We may have another person to join us soon.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so is there any more that needs to be said about Darkship Thieves?
Oh, I could pick it apart and say I like this, I don't like this, till the cows come home. I'm going to say one thing and one other thing only. When world building, you don't have to get too into detail, but please figure out what the economic system is. And especially if you are dealing with things like scarcity of resources.
Okay.
Because I don't care how genetically advanced your world is. If water is at a premium and it is a finite resource to the point where people don't take water showers or water baths because you need to conserve it, don't engineer your living room and dining room to look like a Sylvan Glen. To have actual moss for carpeting, to have actual trees, you know, things like that. and then talk about how, oh, well, you know, there's a shortage on water and we can't find wood anywhere.
Yeah, okay. There's a lot of gimmies in this book.
You figure that stuff out. If you told me, oh, it's all artificial, it just looks like that and it looks pretty, it's like, okay, artificial, done, I don't care. But they make it very clear these are actual plants. And then they go and say there's a conservation of water going on. It's like, then you live in a forest.
Okay, so I think we're just going to end. We can go on a little bit longer because a bunch of people now showed up.
Mm-hmm.
But this has been our review. No, we're not ending the show yet. No. But this has been our review of Darkship Thieves by Sarah A. Hoyt. And again, if you are arriving late, you might want to re-listen to it because I read it and Kat read it, and we had thoroughly different experiences.
Yes, I will say that.
And I let a lot of things slide. It didn't bother me. I just figured, okay, it's space opera. It works that way because it does. And the reason I wanted to review this book so badly was because the female perspective in it, we took it so differently. And clearly what I took as a spoiled brat being humbled and learning to be an adult, you say...
She still can't bring herself to admit to a man that she's wrong.
And would you say that that would have fixed a lot of it?
Would have my big problem with the main character, her name is Athena. My biggest problem with Athena is that, and again, first book, it's very obvious that a big chunk of this is author insert. No, not Mary Sue, but author insert. There is a difference. And so it's like she couldn't quite figure out what she wanted this character to be. Is this character a spoiled Paris Hilton type? Is this character like, you know, a kick-ass motorcycle riding, you know, badass like Pris from Bubblegum Crisis? You know, is this character a gearhead? You know, what is this character? She is all of the things she is whatever Sarah wants her to be at any given point, and most of the time she's nothing. Most of the time she is just the body that the story moves around, and you are told a lot about what Athena's life was like, and the only thing Athena actually does that we see as viewers or as readers is we see her kicking a lot of people, and we do see that she's good with mechanical things. That is it. We're told about everything else about her. We never see it. We don't even get it in flashbacks. In fact, she randomly, this is in a five-act structure. In the third act, Athena randomly starts thinking about some guy that she, you know, slept with a couple of times, but we don't know what her relationship is with him. And Sarah Hoyt doesn't bother to tell us how Athena actually feels about that guy, other than to say, oh yeah, I remember this time we did this. And then we slept together.
And I will say, as if I had been her editor, I would have said, okay, go back and flesh this out. Because
mm-hmm.
that character at the end of the book,
oh, he shows up,
plays a major role.
Yeah, because it's like in the third act, she just randomly decided to start name dropping this guy.
In the
like,
fifth act,
who is this?
In the fifth act, he's a big deal.
But see, yeah, that needed to have been established in, you know, the first one. Maybe even, you know, the book starts with her saying she wakes up and she knows that there's somebody in the room. And she's racking her brain trying to think if she had gone to bed with anybody, which I liked. I liked that. And so it's just, why not just go back and say, you know, at first I thought it was so-and-so, but then I realized the breathing was wrong, or I realized his footsteps were wrong, and no, it wasn't so-and-so, to imply that that guy was on the ship. And her last night there before the mutiny was, you know, her in bed with him. That's all you would need.
I will say the strongest points of this novel, the strongest and the ones that I felt read the most true, mm-hmm. reflect her own background, which is the fact that she was born in a communist country. She found a way to get to the United States. She's an engineer. She's extremely good at math. And she ended up marrying who she described, I think, as the most difficult man in the world in the United States. Mm. As I recall, she had said something to the effect of she had talked to him once on the phone and said, "This is the man I'm marrying," and decided to get to America and marry him.
Really? Wow.
Okay. So, I mean, there's some parallels here, right?
And that's fine, but this is a first-time writer rookie mistake, and that is rookie writers tend to do one of two things: over-explain or under-explain. And she doesn't explain things. It's just, well, this happens. It's like, well, why? Why does your character think this way? Why is she doing the thing that she is doing? Why are other people doing what they are doing? You know, what is their reasoning? What is their logic? Unfortunately, she doesn't explain a lot. So,
you know, early in my career, well, that's kind of a hard thing to say. I mean, God, my career is weird because I started in the music industry and journalism. Mm-hmm. And I was doing music journalism professionally. Then I did graphic design and art for a while and tried to get into the gaming industry. And that was when they were all leaving California. And at age 28, I said, God damn it, I'm almost 30 and I'm not published. Well, I am published as a reviewer, but I mean, I have no fiction published.
Yeah.
And I said, okay, damn it, I'm going to get published. And I do remember the one thing you were as the editor from hell, who I love and love dearly, and I'm glad you are the editor from hell, was how many times you said, well, why is he doing that?
That is the most common question I ask when I'm editing.
Why did this person do this? Why are mm-hmm. they saying that? Mm-hmm. And, you know, after about the thousandth time that your editor says that, it starts to become second nature. I won't kid you. Kat is my editor. She wields a double-bladed, a two-handed chain sword, enchanted by the god of editing,
Thoth.
And we've got a very, very defined relationship of when we're husband and wife, or we're husband and wife. But when she's my editor, I'm not her husband. Mm-hmm. I'm a writer, and she does not go easy on me, and I don't take it personally. When I'm her husband.
Yes.
As a writer, I do.
Yeah, well, we have had very opinionated discussions.
Yes, as a writer, I'll take it very personally, but when it's time to be husband, that's done. Mm-hmm. It's door shut. And I realize not everybody can have that.
Well, we've worked at it.
Yeah. And you know, the ironic thing is I taught you how to edit, and then you became much better at it than me.
Yeah.
I taught you how to analyze stories, and you became better at me at it than me. And so, lucky me, you know, good for me. It's very advantageous. So, you know, when we read things, I will go a lot easier on stuff. A lot of stuff I'll say, oh, I'll let that slide. Kat won't.
No, I won't.
Kat absolutely won't. And before any of you guys write Sarah Hoyt off as just another chick writer.
She's not, actually.
She is actually a very good writer.
Mm-hmm.
She writes many different genres, and just to give her cred, more than once, she has been willing to just step out and call people on their bullshit at conventions
mm-hmm.
and go head-to-head with SJWs, calling them out to their face, and she was one of the leaders of the Sad Puppies.
Yeah.
So, no, don't think she's just some... She's not another chick with a word processor.
No, she has a vast library. This is, if not her first book, it's one of her first. And everybody grows as a person. And,
yeah.
You know, in multiple ways. So, no, it's just, I will say this. If she was farther along in her career and wrote this story, I would just absolutely be loving every single second of it. I mean, there's no, like I said, even though I've said, oh, this is an unforgivable sin, there's at no point where I'm angry at the story.
Bullshit.
No, I haven't been angry.
Okay.
I've been animated and go, oh my God, I can't believe she did that. But really, it's the, oh my God, I can't believe she did that. You know, it's the, it's the equivalent of the you know, bride getting up and saying, I fucked the best man at the wedding. You know, it's like, oh my God, I can't believe she did that.
yeah, that's fair, Wolf.
So no, it is an incredibly enjoyable ride. There's just points where me personally, I'm like, oh no.
But it's an enjoyable ride except for you.
Yes.
It was an enjoyable ride except for you. How about that?
That works.
Because, yeah.
But I share these things because I know we have a lot of writers and hopeful writers.
This is a writing channel. Yeah. We're reviewing a book, and we're reviewing a book by an accomplished writer.
And, you know, I'm pointing out the things that, for me, stick out like thorns. And it's like, if you just don't do that, it would be an awesome story. So
the other thing I would say is, if you decide to dive into Sarah Hoyt's work, her style and her genres vary rapidly, or not rapidly, greatly. She'll do space opera. She'll do sci-fi. But I know that we have some furries in the audience.
Mm-hmm.
Her furry stuff is chick lit. I'm just letting you know, because I tried one of her stories about shapeshifters. Okay, it said urban fantasy. No, it's chick lit.
Urban fantasy.
Is that really?
Yes.
You know,
urban fantasy is code for chick lit.
I don't remember what one it was, but you know, it had the. It's about a girl who ends up in a weird town that she just ends up getting stuck there.
Oh, all of them.
Well, she was traveling and she ended up taking a coffee shop job in a town and ended up staying there too long.
Mm-hmm.
She's a college student. And it turns out that there are shapeshifters that converge on the town. They live there. It's like secret.
Yeah.
And then it turns out she is I believe, a wolf shifter and didn't know it. And there's a love triangle between one, a wolf shifter and a dragon shifter. And
Is she trying to compete with the Mercedes of...
I don't know.
Mercedes... No, I can't remember the last name of the
character. I will say she has no shyness. She her characters... She has no hesitation letting you know that all of her characters are stacked. She has no problem with that.
I can get behind and even in front of that.
Fuzzy people. But yeah, so her shifter stories...
Wolf says that's not furry.
Oh, that's not furry. That's no. Shifter.
Yeah.
Her shifter stories are definitely, I wouldn't call them torso books, because it's not just, you know, an excuse for sex. It's romance.
Horizon Talker. No, not Mercedes Lackey. The character's name is Mercedes. I just can't remember the name of the writer. But anyway.
We're dead air. We need to say something.
Okay. Well, what are you doing?
I'm misspelling Mercedes.
Oh. It's not porn.
Do you mean Mercedes Carrera?
No. Not Mercedes Carrera. No, it's the series by Patricia Briggs. That's the author.
Patricia Briggs.
That my mom is really into. Anita Blake's books are porn, though. Yes.
But yeah, she does have her series about shifters. I tried reading one. It's not for me. No, it's not nonstop sex like Anita Blake. It's love triangle romance, mm-hmm. with shifters and sword fights.
Okay.
I go to Bodice Ripper.
Bodice Ripper. Yeah.
Yeah. Actually, I would give her points for the say that there is no porn in her work. There's nudity, but at no point would I say, okay, well, now we get to hear about what part goes into what part.
Well, that, and I like the fact that, at least in this book, nudity is not taboo.
Oh, yeah, nudity's fine.
You can have modesty, but people are not like, oh, my God, I'm naked. Nor are they, look at me, I'm naked. You know?
I really appreciated the fact that in the books of hers I've read, be it a romance or Darkship Thieves, There's no point in which I turn to page and it's like, oh God, tab A and slot B, and now they're biting.
No, no, none of that. Actually, quite frankly, it's one of those things where it's like, okay, I know why you two love each other, but why do you two love each other? Again, it's the does not explain, and it's simply a, you know, rookie writer thing. You know, it's the assumption of, well, of course these two will get together. Of course they'll love each other. It's like, no, you gotta kind of explain that.
Yeah. So, okay, that's Darkship Thieves. If you're curious about it, it's both in audio on Audible, and it's recently been re-released in soft cover on Amazon. Links are in the description.
And yes, it is a very enjoyable read.
The copy I have is the one with the rear, very, very nice cover. The re-release, although this is a much more accurate representation of the character, it's a poser model.
Yeah.
Hey, Sarah, give me $300. I'll give you a cover that looks like a million times better than that. Seriously, $300. I'll make something much better than this.
You put her in the 90?
Sure, why not?
I think she should be in the 90. That's already ripped. Do it like the cover of Friday.
Yeah, you know, really, this book needed a cover like Friday.
Yeah.
It really felt like it needed a cover. A lot of this was a tribute to Friday.
Yeah.
But without all the graphic sex.
Yes.
God, did that story hit. Heinlein, when Heinlein wrote Friday, that book would have been so much better and so much shorter if he'd just cut out all the gratuitous sex scenes that did not help the book. You know, one or two, fine, okay. But when we're getting to like scene number 11, it's like, and you've got a plot going, it's like, can we get back to story?
Yeah, story, please.
Story, please. Of course, then again, maybe I'm not the intended audience because I've met a ton of young women who love that book.
Mm. I should really read it. I just haven't yet.
I agree. The new cover looks ugly, Wolf.
Iron Cast Knight. I want urban fantasy that's a bunch of gangstas that discover a wizard's library beneath the hood and escalate gang wars to a whole new level.
Like, that would be awesome.
That would be awesome.
You need to write that, Wolf.
That would be amazing. My ex-Navy deviant uncle declared the Anita Blake series as too much for him, so I have avoided them like the coward I am.
No, you're not a coward. You're sane.
No, the problem is that the first three books were decent. I'm not going to say they're high literature, but, you know, for somebody in high school who plays Vampire the Masquerade, those books were great. And then it rapidly devolved into porn and it's like, you know,
I can tell you why it's like
you're expecting the pages to be drippy every time you turn them, and it's just you.
What happened is her husband and her got divorced, and the moment her husband, who co-wrote the books, was gone.
Well, it knowing that, and I know who her husband's insert was, and their breakup was in the books was like really graphic and lots of ew.
Okay.
Lots of ew. And I thought that her dealing with it was basically her husband's insert was a werewolf who transformed on top of Anita in a very ew, was it the American Werewolf in London sort of way. Or what Paris sort of way. And so she drowns her sorrows in fucking a vampire.
How swell.
Yeah, she deals with it by going to the vampire to fuck him.
Now, what the hell? If you guys want us to just do a random cast and chat longer, we can do that. But this is pretty much going to be the end of the episode because we're going to go way off topic otherwise. Although I do want to say something to the audience before we end the show. This is kind of important. Last night's show, the Christmas show, where YouTube pulled the video because I used a public domain movie.
Yes.
I streamed a movie that's been in the public domain since 1959. Mm-hmm. And I showed them up and proved it. YouTube seems to have a grudge against me now. They keep pulling the video down, looking for various excuses why that video should not be up. So it keeps getting pulled up and down, up and down. So if you see last night's episode and you want to watch it, and it's just talking about Christmas. Mm-hmm. Seriously, we don't talk about anything.
No.
It's us just talking about having a good Christmas. YouTube, I don't know. I honestly think they got real mad because they pulled the video and I wrote back to them and told them how much they screwed up because the movie had been public domain since 1959 and included the documentation. Mm-hmm. And they've been jerks about it ever since. So, yeah. So that's what happened. Okay, Fair Maid, a bunch of people say we should come back. When do you want to come back?
When do you want to come back?
I don't know.
Well, like, do you want to do it later this evening? Like in a couple of hours? Or you want to come back sooner than that?
I want you to decide that. What are you in the mood for?
A couple of hours. Let's see. It's coming up 5 o'clock for us now. So
what do you want to do it like 7 or 8?
Yeah, 7 or 8. Somewhere around there.
Maybe
Wolf even says 8 o'clock. So
maybe some friends can join us.
Okay.
Yeah. Or not. I don't know. Eight.
We'll figure it out. But yeah, around
8 o'clock. 8 o'clock.
Around
okay.
7 or 8.
Well, again, thank you for joining us.
Yes.
And again, I'm not telling you not to read this book. I enjoyed it.
I support people reading Sarah's work.
But
it is my job to say where a story can be improved.
It is your job to run it through the meat grinder.
Yes.
So thank you for joining us. Please, if you have not read World War Kaiju, you should.